up being on some chill shit. We go 0 to 100, nigga, real quick. They be on that rap to pay the bill shit. And I don't feel that shit, not even a little bit, oh lord.
We are back with another edition of Man vs. Machine, where we compare the advice of a professional poker coach to that of a solver. In this video, the coach is high stakes pro Ben CB, who also runs one of the biggest coaching sites out there, Raise Your Edge. And the player is Lex Valdez, king of poker streaming.
Stuff. Also, that's the fucking 5-3 guy, you know, so.
Yeah. Ah, well, okay, yeah. I mean, here, same. I mean, we don't need to repeat. It's pretty much the same spot as we had earlier with the 4-4-7 or 7-7-4 against the player pool, just see it 100%. Wow, this really sucks. Nice hold.
Yeah, that's. I mean, it takes a special kind of guy to just use it as a bluffing card, you know?
Yeah.
To just be like, all right, I mean, are you even realistically shoving a five? You know what I mean?
Yeah. I actually don't mind the bluff catchy on the river. I mean, is he really doing it with a five? We can have a shitload of nines in our range.
Doesn't that make a shove stronger though?
But isn't he check raising on this drawbar? I mean, look at your turn sizing. So small. And the board is so drawy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true. I think I just wanted to keep ace highs in with the bet sizing.
Yeah, no, I like the sizing. I think it's pretty decent.
God, I remember this fucking shove. I was so tilted. Oh, yeah. Because this was on a Sunday, and I busted all of my big ones. And then... I had this fucking tournament left that had like 4 hours left of play, and then this hand happened. I was so mad.
Man, I really don't mind the bluff catch here. But usually when they overbet and bluff for the turn, I have it in front of my computer on the billboard. Like when people bluff for the tournament live, just fold. Not people going to start over bluffing against me for the tournament lives.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm just, yeah, whatever, fuck it. I think it's whatever. In theory, these are the spots, in theory it's probably call, we don't block any bluffs. It's better to have king queen in the spot than aces, because we block a little bit of queen nine, and it's just, maybe, well, aces, we block ace nine, but it depends on the big blind. So with blocker effects, it's whatever actually, so.
Yeah.
But I mean, you have jacks, tens, which you can still value bet thin on the turn. Maybe you should call aces, kings sometimes and fold without diamonds. Like all the value adds we have without diamonds and folding them with diamonds. And all the aces, kings or king, queen, ace, queen, queen, jack, jacks we have with one diamond, actually already a lot of combinations. And then additionally, all the random barrels we have, jack, ten, king, jack. In theory, if we fold all of these hands here, let's say king, queen, and also aces, kings, he's exploiting us if he would do it as a bluff.
True, yeah, right? I was thinking
that. That's you have to be aware of. So now you make an exploitable fold, but you make yourself also susceptible towards becoming exploited by yourself, from your opponent.
Yeah.
So, if you really think he's never doing it as a bluff, that's totally fine. And it's going to win you a lot of money.
In this hand, it appears that we're in the middle stages of a tournament nine-handed, and the action folds around to Lex on the cutoff with around 44 big blinds, and he opens it up 2.2x with king-queen off, and the big blind with around 23 big blinds calls. To approximate what the GTO ranges should look like in this specific spot, we've run a custom sim with the exact stack sizes and ante from this game using simple preflop. And with its new bucketing scheme, this sim took less than 2 minutes from start to finish, which is pretty astonishing. The flop comes 995, and Lex continues with around a third pot bet. On this paired board, Ben suggests just c-betting range against the player pool, and we see that the solver is doing quite a lot of betting on this flop. Although the big blind has more 9x in its range, overall its range is very wide, which mostly misses this type of paired board. On the other hand, Lex, as the preflop aggressor, has a much tighter range, which gives him a significant advantage throughout. There are a few combos with marginal equity, such as weak pairs and gut shots, that prefer checking to preserve equity, but when we remove just a handful of these combos, we see that the EV regret for betting all of these hands drops down to just 1% of the pot, as a vast majority of the range bets here with at least some frequency. The big blind calls, the turn is the queen of clubs, giving Lex top pair, and he continues with another small bet around 30%. This queen definitely favors Lex's range, since he retains virtually all of his queen X from the flop, given that most of his range c-bet, whereas the big blind shed most of its unpaired queen X, other than queen X with two diamonds and a few stronger queen X combos with a backdoor flush draw. Additionally, with the SPR being very low, there's a relatively large portion of the cutoff's range that should be perfectly happy stacking off at this depth. The combined effects of these factors results in almost 80% of the range betting, including essentially all top pairs plus. And Lex could have even bet larger here, given how wet the board is, but the small bet appears to be fine as well, since it won't be difficult to get stacks in on blank rivers. The river is the five of spades, double pairing the board. The big blind shoves, and Lex folds. Based on the back and forth, it appears that Lex made this fold on the assumption that Villain has no bluffs in this spot, stating that it takes a special kind of guy to use this river card as a bluff. But is that really the case? Well, although of course no one can play exactly like the solver, it actually shoves over 30% of its range in this spot. Is this some crazy obscure meta play that only the solver can find? Or is there a reasonable rationale for this type of move? Let's dig into this spot further to see if we can make any sense of what's happening here. The first question we need to ask is whether it's reasonable for Villain to have a decent number of 9x and 5x in this spot. Well, recall that Lex made small bets on both the flop and turn, which means Villain should have defended a bunch of 5x. And it also seems pretty reasonable that Villain could have slow played some 9x as well, even though some 9x combos were likely to raise on the flop or turn. So if it's reasonable to assume Villain has a number of full houses on the river, the next question is, does it make any sense for those full houses to donk shove? Well, let's consider what the likely outcome would be if Villain checked instead by thinking about Lex's likely response to a check by the big blind. As an initial matter, we can put aside the full houses in Lex's range because if both players have full houses here, stacks are likely going in the middle regardless of what the big blind does. So from an EV perspective, the big blind checking or betting in this scenario would be a wash. Of Lex's remaining range, the vast majority of the combos are comprised of mid-strength hands, due in part to the small bets he placed on the flop and turn, which kept much of his pre-flop range intact. Almost 27% are pocket pairs and queen X, 21% are ace high, and 19% are king high. And of this group, when facing a check, these hands check back over 80% of the time. On the double paired board, ace high has great showdown value, so it's a pretty standard check back. King high has some showdown value as well. It also blocks some of the bricked draws in the big blind's range, like king jack and king 10 that picked up the gut shot on the turn. So it's not a great candidate to bluff with in Lex's shoes. Most of the two pairs in Lex's range also just try to realize their equity instead of reopening the action, other than some of the stronger two pairs that do not block the big blind's weaker calling range. So given that most of Lex's range is comprised of mid-strength hands that want to check back on this board, if the big blind was holding a full house, which we established is very possible, it makes sense for the big blind to have some donks here to ensure another bet gets in on the last street to maximize its EV. And so the solver actually donks with over 95% of its full houses, with a very low EV regret for shoving all of these hands. And if it's the case that the big blind has a strong incentive to shove here for value, then you don't really need to be a sicko to recognize the simple fact that you need some bluffs as well. This is likely why Ben suggests that he wouldn't mind bluff catching with Lex's hand, and he cites a couple reasons for this. First and foremost, he states that Lex's hand is unblocking many of Villain's bluffs. So what are Villain's bluffs? Well, given the big blind's line here, his range is extremely polarized, consisting pretty much of only full houses and total trash that can't beat the board. So let's isolate Lex's bluff catchers against this range, which make up this long line of middling hands that lose to all of Villain's value but beat all of his bluffs. Since Villain's range is so polarized, this group contains hands as strong as pocket aces and as weak as king high, and all of these hands have virtually the same equity. So how do we distinguish between this group of similar combos? We can't call all of them, or we would be way over calling, and we can't fold all of them, or we would be way over folding. Well, probably the easiest thing to do would be to just randomize based on the size of the bet in relation to the pot. We see that the max EV loss for calling and folding for all of these combos in this bucket is only 2-3%. But if we want to be more precise with our bluff catching, there's one objective distinguishing factor that changes the actual probabilities of the game, making it more or less likely that Villain is bluffing: card removal. If we filter our bucket by hands with the lowest unblocker scores, we see that these hands fold over 90% of the time with an EV regret of just 0.2%, and when we peruse these hands, we see some commonalities: diamonds, clubs, sixes, sevens, and eights. Holding a card with any of these attributes would block many of the bluffs that are present in Villain's range. The most common combos in Villain's range that call the flop and turn, other than a 5 or 9, were gut shots, flush draws, and stronger backdoor flush draws. So even though missed draws typically aren't the best bluffing candidates, when that's all that you have in your range, and you have many value combos to support, you're just going to have to pull the best bluffs you have from this group. And the way we rationally distinguish between our good bluffs and bad bluffs is also based on card removal. Villain's combos with the lowest unblocker scores are these Jack 10, 8-7, and 8-6 combos with a diamond and club, and 10x with two diamonds. These hands block both numerous straight and flush draws in Lex's range, making it more likely that he has value. So these hands are doing a lot of checking with a very low EV regret for check. At the other end of the spectrum, we have Villain's trash that have the highest unblocker scores. These are low-ranked flush draws, which unblock a much lower percentage of Lex's missed flush draws, since most of his flush draws are comprised of high or middling cards. So holding these combos make it a bit more likely that Lex has a weaker hand, relatively speaking, resulting in a lot of bluffing with a zero EV regret for a donk. And finally, we have the stuff in the middle that, based on how these specific ranges match up, block just a slightly greater proportion of Lex's missed draws, resulting in this class doing some betting and some checking with a relatively low EV regret for all actions. In addition to unblocking Villain's bluffs, another bluff catching factor Ben mentioned was blocking Villain's value combos, suggesting that aces are not the best calling candidate because Villain shouldn't have much ace 9 in its range. And this appears to be an accurate assessment when we bucket Lex's bluff catchers with decent unblocking properties but bad blocking properties. We see that all of Lex's aces are in this bucket, and overall these hands are folding nearly 100% of the time. As you may recall, in our custom sim, ace 9 off was raising nearly in full preflop in the big blind's shoes. In contrast, the hands with the best unblocker and blocker scores are nearly calling in full. This group includes deuce through four of hearts and clubs, which are blocking these 5x combos that are prevalent in Villain's value range, as well as queen of diamonds, which blocks queen 9, and pocket jacks with a heart and club, which blocks these jack 5 combos. That all being said, as a practical matter, being able to identify this level of minutiae regarding how the ranges specifically match up on the river is essentially impossible in real time, so I think it's important to highlight the simplified heuristic offered by Ben. He recognized the fact that Villain has many busted diamond flush draws in his range, so he suggested that one way to differentiate among Lex's bluff catchers would be to simply call all combos without a diamond and fold all combos with a diamond, and this heuristic is something that is both rational and relatively easy to implement for us human beings. If we filter our bluff catchers by combos that have one or two diamonds, We see that these hands fold over 80% of the time, with a low EV regret for fold and a very high EV regret for call. In contrast, if we filter the same hands by combos without a diamond, we see that the calling frequency shoots up to 44% with an EV regret call of 3%. And if we refine this bucket even further by also excluding clubs, which block some of Villain's missed club draws, we see that the call frequency now raises to 62% with an EV regret call of only 1%. So overall, this was an interesting hand where Ben offered very practical advice that in principle was quite consistent with the solver strategy. And Ben also mentioned the fact that if Villain is not bluffing enough here, then overfolding is the correct play, which we were also able to confirm through node locking. So that's the video for today. Thanks for watching. Until next time, stay balanced.
0 to 100, nigga, real quick. Real quick. Whole squad on that real shit. 0 to 100, nigga, real quick. Real quick. Real fucking quick, nigga.